police knocked on the door, and my initial thought was maybe he's done something wrong. But I knew immediately, I thought that, just by looking at these two policemen, who were amazing, that this was, he hadn't done anything wrong, something, he'd had an accident without a doubt. The music was always the major part,
yes,
wasn't it?
Yes, I mean, he did what all typical boys do, you know, played with guns, played with soldiers. He was very good at entertaining himself. Mm-hmm. Very, very able, had lots of friends, and very extrovert, and energy, terrific energy. But I dreaded going into the school or receiving his school reports, because it was always, you know, could do better. He was a very caring child, but competitive. And being the eldest of three boys, he was very competitive with the others.
Yay. I win by
draw.
He just always had an incredible sort of pace and intensity. He's always on to the next thing.
So much time has passed, but he was stubborn, you know, and just would he just seem to go his own way always.
I remember Rupert sort of flying in and out the house. He never stayed for very long. He was always on the go.
I took him once for a violin lesson, and he opened the violin case. There was no violin. He'd stuffed it full of Snoopies and teddy bears. He did have not only the musical talent, but he had the performing skills. He loved the stage from a small boy, wanted to be the centre of attention, always. And by the time he was 15, he was in the National Youth Orchestra. And he was so actually full of living life. There was no time or space in it.
You cannot explain how the physical reaction that goes straight down through you at this sudden realization that your son has had this awful accident. The doorbell rang, and I thought that Rupert had once again not got his door key, so I came running around down the stairs, opened the door, and there are two policemen standing there. And one said, "Are you the owner of K798XBM? I'll never forget those words, because immediately I fell backwards.
He was just coming off the M25, going on to the M1. You know, he was moments from home. And he went into the back of an articulated lorry. Whether Rupert fell asleep or lost concentration, we'll never know. I was supposed to be getting ready for school. And then there was a phone call at about 8:30. And Mum just sounded not like my mum. She just said, the police are coming to pick you up. And I got ready. I picked up a Snoopy from Rupert's bed, thinking he'll be sat up in hospital bed and that'll make him feel better. I think you realise quite quickly that this is more than just a broken leg.
It's all such a blur, it's such a shock. That awful kind of empty feeling when you don't really know what's going to happen. And of course, just huge. It was just these feelings for Rupert, you know, who was such a kind of, you know, of all the people for it to have happened to, Rupes, just didn't seem fair, you know. And I just felt so bloody sorry for him. I just felt so sorry for him. It was awful, absolutely awful.
I remember going up to Rupert's room and just sort of, you know, had a particular sort of smell to the room that I remember as my brother, you know, just like, and the way everything was laid out just from the night before, there was just something about, you know, just being in there and looking up the road and hoping we'd see him turn up, you know, somehow.
And they did the operation, I can't remember, a month later.
Mm-hmm.
And that was 13 hours of operation. He had every conceivable setback, and the whole town rallied round. I can't tell you, they brought food, they came and they were there.
Flowers, the place was like a florist shop,
yes,
wasn't it?
It was amazing how people rallied round.
In the early stages, we were in a state of shock. We thought that we could
get him
return
better.
Rupert to normal. Bit by bit, it dawned on us that Rupert was never going to lead an independent
life.
Ever.
And so I don't know quite what we would have done without the Brain Injury Rehabilitation Trust. They never give up on him. So if this program to try and stop him, whatever he's doing that he shouldn't be doing, if this doesn't work, they'll reroute it and try something else. And they're wonderful, because from the second he gets up in the morning, you're bombarded with can I do this, can I do that, you know, all day long. And they are absolute saints.
The amazing thing now, the positives, are that we still have Rupert, and he is the character that he has always been. He's full of life in many ways. And, you know, despite the difficulties of trying to integrate him somehow into society, he's very fortunate to have the backing he does with Bert and with Kent House in Aylesbury. He's got a loving family. He comes home as much as he can.
The memory I most like to cherish, really, about Roo is just National Youth Orchestra playing a big Bruckner symphony. And, you know, on these courses, you're amongst loads of friends and everything. And Rupert had this incredible solo. And it was the moment that everybody was listening out for. That moment when he played the solo, the whole room just stood still. Everyone to this day remembers it. An utterly special, unique musician. And that was that.
The reason I wanted to do the Eyes of Light appeal is because I feel whenever you go into Kent House and you spend time with people, they really light up. You know, it's all in their eyes.
So we were talking about it in the car, and she was talking about how their eyes light up when she goes to talk to them. And I suddenly said, what about Eyes of Light? She thinks that every one of the clients might have something special that they want to do. That's really what she set her heart on.
There's a particular lady at Kent House called Lavinia. She loves the ballet. And I know that for her, a trip to Covent Garden would be really special for her. I wanted to do the Eyes of Light appeal to be able to give a bit of TLC and to give people at Kent House and Rupert things to live for and smile about again. And we hope to work closely with their carers to give them something to look forward to and give them the chance to speak about their talents and have the confidence to go out and really explore them. You know, every individual in Kent House has a talent, a dream. They've all got a story. They've all, you know, got so much to offer and to tell. And it's almost like Eyes of Light gives them a chance to continue their ambitions and their dreams.
So are they all your friends?
Yeah, they are, yeah.
And does it help when you see them?
Yeah, it does, yeah.
Brightens you up.
Brightens you up, yeah.
Here comes the sun, little darling. Here comes the sun, I say, it's all right. burning to the faces now, little darling.